Welcome to week three, where we're going to focus on diets, food systems, and climate change. We'll look at how climate change is impacting diets and food systems, and how food system diets are also contributing to climate change. So in this first module of week three, we're going to just cover some basics. What is the Anthropocene? And how are food systems impacted by and impacting climate change? So let's get started. So what is the Anthropocene? Well, it defines Earth's most recent geologic time period that's human influenced. It is our human footprint on atmospheric, geological, hydrological, biospheric, and other Earth system processes. We are the biggest instigator of the change to Earth systems, how we live our lives, what we throw out, what we don't throw out. Our footprint has become the biggest instigator of change, much of that being quite negative for the planet and natural resources. This term Anthropocene is not new. Paul Crutzen and others came up with it decades ago. But really, this idea of this human footprint and its significance has gained in the literature, it's gained in media, and you'll see lots of papers published on the Anthropocene. There's journals dedicated to the term Anthropocene. And you often also hear the term the sixth extinction. Are we going to spur the next extinction on the planet? So we really see an uptick in how humans are driving the decline of life on the planet. And you see a lot of papers coming out describing this decline and what we can do to try to reverse that. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or the IPCC, is a high-level body that reviews science on climate, and they publish a report every 5 years. In 2018, they published a report, Global Warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius, where they really looked at what will the world look like at 1.5 degree, and what can we do to respond to avoiding that 1.5 degree warming of the planet. And I like this quote in that they say, the challenge of avoiding catastrophic climate breakdown requires rapid, far-reaching, and unprecedented changes in all aspects of society. So it's not just climate change. Everything needs to change. The way we live our lives and our relationship with the planet needs to profoundly be altered. This is a paper that Ripple and colleagues published in 2017, in which they looked at a paper published back in 1992, where some scientists got together and issued a warning to humanity. They looked at natural resources, they looked at Earth processes, and they said, well, here we are in 1992, what's going to happen as we move into the second decade of the 2000s? And this group in 2017 looked back at the warning and said, well, were these scientists right? Well, it turns out they were. They did see that freshwater resources were declining. And you can see this black line from 92 to 2016 shows what they predicted turned out to be right. Marine catch declining, increased dead zones, increased deforestation, species abundance declining or collapsing, greenhouse gas emissions rising, temperature changes rising, of course, the population rising. And it's not just that these scientists were right 25 years ago, it's that the pace of change has been accelerated in the last two decades. What you often see known as the hockey stick approach. Michael Mann, the climate scientist, talks about this hockey stick effect. we've seen this acceleration in some of these processes happen that have been quite detrimental to the earth and to natural resources. And a paper just came out looking at, well, how is the world going to live? And this paper models that by 2050, roughly 1.2 billion people will be living in areas that are so hot, they're in the hottest parts of the Sahara. So people will be living in very, very hot climates in 30 plus years. And of course, that is not totally livable or livable at all. And of course, we can imagine what will happen is there'll be massive migration. So climate-induced migration that will move people around the planet, further straining resources, further straining governments, further straining food supply chains. So those who are living in what they call the comfortable climate niche will decrease, and more people will be living in very, very hot climates. So what about food systems? How do food systems instigate climate change, and why are they sometimes a victim? So I'm coming back to this framework that I introduced in week one. This is our food system. It's very complex. It has multiple elements. It has many drivers that are shaping and shifting their behavior. And of course, there's many actors that interact along this entire system, whether it's global or local. And of course, climate change and natural resources are big drivers of food system functionality, their progress, and whether or not they're able to produce enough food. So when we think about the global food system, we've seen massive acceleration. It's become very efficient at producing food. It's become very efficient at moving food around the world. But it also has some externalities, some of those being negative, that have implications on the environment, like our use of pesticides and fertilizers, like emissions coming from agriculture, like land use being used for agriculture, which we're hovering around 40% of all arable land is used for agriculture. Indoor and outdoor air pollution, some of that coming from agriculture, not just energy and transportation. So we've seen these upticks in positive outcomes of the global food system with its growth and acceleration, but also some negative consequences. So if we think about agriculture using 40% roughly of the Earth's land for food production on really pastures, as well as on cultivated crops, you can look at the greenhouse gas emissions coming from that. And when you look at land use change and agriculture production, agriculture accounts for about 25% of greenhouse gas emissions. Now that comes from different ways of producing food, but most of those greenhouse gas emissions either are resulting in CO2 emissions, methane, or nitrous oxide, which are two more pretty potent greenhouse gases. When we look at where those greenhouse gases are coming from, it's coming from ruminant enteric fermentation, ruminant waste on pastures, manure management, the energy used to produce food in agriculture, fertilizers, a lot of nitrous oxide coming from that, and methane from rice production. So it's not just cows that are producing greenhouse gases and the movement of those large beasts. It's also other inputs into agriculture to just grow the diverse food that we have on the planet. So it's about 25% of greenhouse gas emissions, obviously the other coming from energy and transportation. But when we think about contributions of greenhouse gases, most of that measurement sits at the production phase. But we know that there's disruption and vulnerability of climate change across the entire food supply chain. So you can imagine in distribution and storage, there's vulnerabilities with a warming planet or a wetter or a drier planet. We know that food prices can change and food availability issues. Consumption can change, risk to pathogens that grow in warmer climates. So across the entire food supply chain, we have to think about the vulnerability points that the food system is susceptible to in the context of climate change, that being a warmer world, that being a world where we are prone to climate-related natural disasters like floods, droughts, hurricanes, typhoons. And with that vulnerability comes more risk, more uncertainty, more violent episodes of natural-related climate-related natural disasters. So we have to be thinking across the entire supply chain. We can maybe produce enough food, but can we move it in the context of significant climate change? So just some more drilling down a bit. Well, what will food production look like in the context of a changing climate? This is looking at crop yields of crops around the world in a 3-degree warmer world, a very devastated world, one that we all hope we do not ever reach. And you can see in red is showing you a percentage change in yields, red showing a decline, green showing an increase. And you can see most of the southern tropics, sub-Saharan Africa, into the Middle East, North Africa, South America, Southeast Asia, Australia, and parts of the southern areas of the United States will experience a decrease in crop quantity, crop production. Whereas the very northern parts of the world, Canada, Russia, will experience bumper crops. And there's a lot of work going on around what's called multiple breadbasket failures. So extreme weather events or climate-related weather events such as heat waves, droughts, flooding, cold spells could potentially lead to devastating crop failures of major crop commodities like maize, rice, wheat, soybeans. And there's a thought that these events will co-occur and cause multiple breadbasket failures at the same time. And this could put a significant number of people at food insecurity risk, billions. And there's some pretty strong models and evidence to suggest that this will happen in the context of a business as usual approach if we do not avoid climate collapsing and catastrophe. So these multiple breadbasket failures. And we've seen glimpses of that in 2008 during the food price crisis. There was breadbasket failures that had significant repercussions on food security, social conflict, and unrest. There's also some work being done by a few groups, one being Sam Myers at Harvard, looking at the nutritional quality of crops under a CO2 fertilization effect. Higher levels of CO2 in the atmosphere will change the nutritional composition of crops. And this is looking at, again, some major crop commodities like wheat, rice, soybeans, maize, sorghum, peas, showing that zinc, iron, protein will all be decreasing. So the nutritional composition will be of those key nutrients, zinc and iron being micronutrients critically important for cognition, growth, immunity, reproduction, will be declining along with protein in this higher, warmer CO2 world. Agriculture areas will continue to be water stressed. They already are, but we'll see more water stress. This is showing you by 2025, in higher temperatures. This is a scenario, the IPCC scenario A1B, which is called a convergent world, moderate climate change action, but not enough. And we see the water stress shown in red in some of these places. You can see right in the plains. This is the breadbasket of the United States, right along, right below the Sahel and the Sahara. You see some massive water stress. And of course, look at India here, big water stress issues. And this is also looking now at a map of diversity of landscape. So biodiversity, that's the variety of species that the land provides, and the flora and fauna. And this shows, in a business as usual approach, you can see the threat to biodiversity from climate change. And you can see this highlighting. And this is now in a more ideal situation. We still see threats to many species, but much less so as compared to a business as usual, really no action on climate change, like what we have pretty much currently happening right now. And safety of food will change. Some pathogens will thrive in warmer climates, some will do worse. And this is showing you aflatoxin, which is a mycotoxin found in foods such as peanuts, maize, rice, causes liver cancer. It's been associated with childhood stunting. And we see that aflatoxin contamination in three different scenarios: present, a 2-degree world, very warm, 5-degree world, catastrophic for life as we know it. And you see aflatoxin showing in red, the concentration and contamination of that increasing in a warmer world. So that's one example of where safety of food is put at risk in warmer climates. And we'll stop there, and I'll see you in the next module. So welcome to module 3.2 of week 3. Let's examine how our diets are impacting climate change. So when we look at food production, what is produced on the land from agriculture, we look at different food groups shown here in different colors. So animal products being in red, staple grains, maize, rice, wheat being in a darker blue, fruits and veg in green. We can look at the footprint to grow those foods across the environment. So let's look at 5 different indicators: greenhouse gas emissions, land use changes, water use, so the water footprint, nitrogen application or eutrophication, and phosphorus application or acidification. When we look at these different ranges of environmental indicators and the food that is produced and the footprint on those environmental indicators, we see that in 2010 and into 2050, in a business as usual scenario for climate change, animal products have a big greenhouse gas footprint. When we look at the other indicators and across other foods, we can see that different foods have different environmental footprints. So staple grains have quite a significant footprint on land use, water use, nitrogen and phosphorus application. Fruits and veg can have a big footprint. So it really depends on how food is grown, where it's grown, and by who. The life cycle assessment, watching the energy inputs and outputs of food from birth, from cradle to grave, as they call it, have different environmental footprints. So obviously, animal source foods have a big greenhouse gas footprint, but we can think about avocados, cashews having a big water footprint, cheese having a water footprint, staple grains having a pretty significant environmental footprint, particularly on land use and other indicators. Many of these staple grains, at least 50%, are being fed to animal products that we then are consuming. So there's really a double hit with animal production systems and their impacts on the environment. Now, some scientists argue that the greenhouse gases coming from cows, depending on which greenhouse gas you look at, whether it's CO2 or methane, have different impacts. With methane, sometimes some scientists argue that it has a zero net effect. It really depends, again, on where food is grown and how it's grown and which system we're talking about. Our dietary patterns also matter for health and the environment. When we look at patterns, that means vegetarianism, a Mediterranean-type diet, a pescatarian or fish-based diet, a vegan diet. These patterns can have an impact on health and environment. One of the most studied health pattern, dietary patterns is the Mediterranean diet, which has profound positive impacts on many health outcomes like cardiovascular disease, Alzheimer's, cancer risk across a number of neoplasms. So we can look at different dietary patterns and their impact. This graph is showing you as compared to the omnivorous diet, the Western type, sort of anything goes type diet, and you compare the Mediterranean, pescatarian, and vegetarian diet to that omnivorous diet, you can see the reduction in risk of diabetes, cancer, coronary mortality, and all-cause mortality declines with these more plant-based or plant-forward or flexitarian type diets like the Mediterranean, pescatarian, and vegetarian. So they offer a protective effect against some of these non-communicable diseases. We then take those diets and look at the food groups coming from those, the major food groups. Here's the vegetarian, pescatarian, Mediterranean, and the omnivorous diet, which includes livestock. You can see the impacts on greenhouse gases per kcal, that the more vegetarian you go, the lower the greenhouse gas footprint, where the more meats you consume, the more fish you consume, you start to introduce greenhouse gases. Now, fish, there's four bars here because this really depends on the type of fish and how the fish is harvested. Trawling type fisheries that drag seabed, the bottom of the seabeds, are more intensive on greenhouse gas emissions as compared to line caught fish, for example. And obviously the type of fish, whether it's big tuna versus small shellfish like oysters and clams, have different environmental footprints. Now, this is just greenhouse gas emissions. You can look at other environmental indicators like shrimp, other environmental indicators like impacts on certain landscapes like mangroves, like on equestrian type systems. And you can see different impacts of foods on those ecosystems, these aquatic type ecosystems like shrimp having a big impact on some more fragile ecosystems. So it really depends, again, on the types of foods, the types of environments, the types of landscapes you're looking at, and the environmental indicators. So you all had in your reading the Eat Lancet Commission. This was a landmark commission. A report came out in early 2019. It was led by Johan Rockström here, who really helped develop the planetary boundaries idea, and Walter Willett at Harvard, who is a nutrition epidemiologist that really spearheaded the diet recommendations of the Eat Lancet. I'm going to walk you through some of the major findings of the Eat Lancet because it so much has shaped the dialogue in politics and in science over the last year looking at human and planetary health. So the Eat Commission did a few things. It defined what's considered a healthy reference diet. It defined six planetary boundaries of environmental systems and processes that we do not want to surpass. And then it modeled combinations to stay within those planetary boundaries and meet our dietary needs for a world's population by 2050. So what kind of a diet should we consume that's good for us and good for the planet? And then what strategies need to be taken to do that? So let me walk you through this Eat Lancet study, which was critically important. And for the planetary health diet, a diet that meets the needs of everyone in 2050, ages 2 and older, they pulled from the literature, looked at randomized controlled feeding studies, they looked at observational cohort studies with long-term follow-up, and then randomized trials of dietary patterns and looked at disease outcomes. And this is the diet they came up with. They said this was a universal diet. You could plug in different elements of foods that fit within a culture or society. So in China, it would be rice. In West Africa and Nigeria, it would be cassava. So you could really plug in different types of foods, and they were very prescriptive in the type of diet it was and gave you a range in grams per day of these foods and kcals. And you can see here the range of intake for animal source foods was incredibly low. And this was the most controversial piece of this recommended diet, was that the animal source food consumption, not just beef, but chicken, eggs, fish, were incredibly low. And if you just look at the plate, this is what the diet looks like. Very rich in fruits and veg, whole grains, very minimal animal source proteins, more plant source proteins like legumes, and minimal added sugars and starchy staples. And when they modeled the impacts of this reference diet on health, they used three different independent models, and those three models found that roughly 10 to 11 million adult deaths per year were averted if the world were to take on this type of diet. So it had quite a protective effect on health. But when they looked at, well, what are current diets and how far off are they from this planetary diet? So this is showing you meeting that planetary diet at 100%. And this shows you globally in orange and different major regions of the world in the other colors. And what you see is that many regions are not meeting the health-promoting diet intake of the healthy reference diet, particularly veg, fruits, legumes, whole grains, and nuts. So you can see there's a big deficit there. Whereas the animal source foods and starchy staples, you see some regions meeting the healthy reference diet or even surpassing it. And just to give you a bit of a more visually easier to understand image, this is showing you the global dietary intake. And here is the health reference diet shown at 100%, just like the other graph. And this is showing you red meat, and this is showing you starchy staples, and this is eggs. So much of the world is consuming way more than they need of red meat, starchy staples, and eggs. Here's North America. Look at the difference there. We consume a lot of animal source foods, a lot of starchy staples, dairy, chicken, eggs, red meat. Here's sub-Saharan Africa, right? A lot of starchy staples in the boundary for red meat, not enough of the good stuff. Same with the United States, not enough of the health-promoting stuff, the fruits, the veg, the legumes, the nuts, the seeds. Here's South Asia. Really staying within the health boundary, but not getting enough of the good stuff. So there's a real inequity here. In North America, we're consuming just way more than we need to of animal source foods, beyond what's required for our human health, beyond the boundaries of climate change. And in South Asia, they're not getting enough. So there's a real inequity of the haves and the have-nots. And so what do we do about that? So some ethical considerations that we need to think about, and we're going to talk about this more in week four, who suffers the consequences of the world's dietary choices? Do we have the right to eat wrongly anymore? In the United States, energy-intensive lifestyles and dietary choices are big contributors to climate change. We know that now. But the economically poor, where the poor and the vulnerable will experience disproportionately the burden and the impacts on climate change. It will be much harder for them to adapt, much harder for their countries to mitigate against climate change. So if we think about the global food system, connectivity, we as global citizens, do we have the right to just keep consuming all the meat we want to, keep living unsustainably, keep wasting lots of food? It's a big question. How do we address these inequities? Now, this is a paper showing you different types of meats red meat, milk, white meat, eggs, fish, other dairy and processed meats. And it's showing you from very cheap in light gray, cheap and gray, and then very expensive in the blue. And what you see is that I want you to focus here on high to low income countries. You can see that animal source foods are incredibly expensive for low and middle income countries. And you can see that in Africa, you see the expense in some parts of Asia as compared to Europe and the Americas. And so it becomes incredibly difficult for some countries, some communities, some households to be able to afford animal source foods, even if they wanted it. And it really begs the question of why are we consuming so much in high-income countries and some populations can't get access to enough? And there's a real divide. We do need some animal source foods. They are an important source of nutrients. You can live without animal source foods and be a vegetarian if you choose. But they do, in certain amounts, contribute to human health. And so how do we reconcile these demands? In the face of growing economies, globalization, trade, and urbanization. Another interesting study mapped out the Eat Lancet diet and its cost. And it turns out that 1.6 billion people cannot afford the Eat Lancet diet. 1.6 billion currently. They're living below the poverty line or living at the poverty line. And these are just too expensive. Now, I showed you in the earlier slide, animal source foods are very expensive due to poor food supply chains, not poor distribution, poor storage. And you can argue that the Eat Lancet diet is quite plant-based. And adding animal source foods would be even more expensive for these some of these populations. So you can imagine that if you had more eggs, more dairy, more chicken, more fish to the Eat Lancet diet, there'd be even more than 1.6 billion people who could not afford that diet. So there's a real inequity. Another big ethical debate is why are we raising meat when they require so much energy? Here's energy, per pound of protein, fossil fuel use, water per kilogram of meat, and feed per kilogram of meat. So if half of cereal production is being used to feed these animals, is that ethically permissible when we still have 821 million people going to bed hungry? Is that the best use of that 40% land mass? Is it the best use? Or could we be growing more calories, more food to feed a growing population? So this is obviously a big question. Now, this is a little bit misleading in that when you look at one individual cow and compare it to one chicken, that's not what food production systems look like. For every cow, there's 100 chickens being produced. So this number is actually bigger when you look at the environmental footprint of chickens because there's just so many more chickens being produced as compared to cows. And last is, what options are ethically permissible and acceptable? We are now in a phase where alternative proteins are being tested and tried. We have the plant-based burgers like Beyond Burger and Impossible Burger. Looks like meat, smells like meat, bleeds like meat, but it's not meat. We soon will have lab-grown meats, finless foods, fish grown from stem cells. Are consumers willing to consume these foods? We might get in a situation like genetically modified foods where people call them Frankenstein foods. You know, so are we going to be in a situation where there's low acceptability? And that's yet to be seen of how we face and accept and value these future foods. See you in the next module. Welcome to Module 3.3, where we're going to discuss how we move towards healthy and sustainable diets. This is a diagram just published by FAO and WHO outlining what are considered the elements of healthy and sustainable diets. They should have acquire health implications, environment, and sociocultural aspects. When you read closely the recommendations across health, environment, and sociocultural, it very much reads like the Eat Lancet recommendations that we talked about in the last module. More of a plant-based diet, avoiding food-borne illnesses, thinking about greenhouse gas emissions, water footprints, biodiversity, and of course, ensuring that these diets are acceptable, accessible, and desirable. And just so you know, although FAO and WHO published this, there is no United Nations agreed definition of what is considered a healthy and sustainable diet. And it is a very contested issue currently in UN debate. Now let's go back to the Eat Lancet. They modeled what the ideal healthy diet should look like. They modeled the planetary boundaries. Well, what actions can be taken and what would the world look like? So they modeled a couple of things. They modeled this healthy plant-based diet. They modeled, well, what if the world cut food loss and waste in half? What if we improved food production to make it more sustainable, rebalancing nitrogen and phosphorus application, improving water management, thinking about land conservation, minimal impacts on biodiversity. So they modeled this, and what they found when they looked across those five environmental indicators that we talked about earlier, greenhouse gas emissions, land, water use, and nitrogen and phosphorus application, they found that the diet shown here in green, this plant-based flexitarian diet, had a big impact on greenhouse gas emission reductions. But other options are important as well. Cutting food loss and waste in half, shown in yellow, has a big impact across the suite of environmental indicators, as does more sustainable food production practices on farms, shown here in gray. The point being is that there are many options to stay within the environmental limits of the planet. We need diet changes. We need technology changes on farms. We need to reduce food loss and waste. And of course, we need better governance overall. So this is a great diagram showing you if we were to try to reduce greenhouse gas emissions coming from food systems, we would really need to do a multiple pronged solution to get to that. So if we look at what it would take to get to what's called a 2050 target of a much lower greenhouse gas emissions coming from agriculture, the World Resources Institute said we have a menu of options. First is to reduce growth in demand for food and other ag products. The second is to increase food production without expanding on more land. Don't go above that 40% arable land used currently. Increase the fish supply in sustainable ways. Reduce greenhouse gas emissions coming from agriculture production. And protect and restore natural ecosystems. And when you look across the different solutions, you can see reducing food loss and waste, shifting diets to more plant-based, phasing out biofuels, crop-based biofuels, reproductive fertility rate declines, increasing crop yields, improving wild fisheries management, increasing sustainable aquaculture, reducing enteric fermentation coming from cows, many solutions to do that in the works right now, improving manure management, restoring peatlands, many different options. And there have been a plethora of papers showing the different options to adapt and mitigate against climate change. In the Eat Lancet, they recommended five transformations that need to happen in the food system. The first is to make major shifts towards healthier diets. We need governments to take action. We've got soft policy options like dietary guidelines, giving consumers information, but we also need hard policies, regulation. things like restricting food marketing of junk food to children, putting taxes on junk food, maybe taxes on red meat, beefing up the health system to deliver better dietary advice, better public health information campaigns, better education systems. We need policies across all scales, from city level to national to global cooperation. The second strategy they recommend is to reorient agriculture priorities from producing high quantities of staple food, which is the typical model of agriculture, to producing healthier foods. And if the world were to move towards this planetary diet that the Eat Lancet recommends, which is shown in green, and we cut food waste in half, as compared to the typical business as usual type diet and keep wasting food shown in green, by 2050, this is what food production systems would look like. Look at this. No increases in cereal production, increases in vegetable and fruits, massive reductions in red meat production, very controversial amongst the livestock industry to see this, increases in fish, legumes, nuts, and seeds. So our agriculture food production systems would need to look very differently. And this creates controversy, creates trade-offs. Some will win in this scenario, and some will lose. And that's the controversy of how do we change these food production systems. We know now, and this is just showing you fruits and vegetable demand. If everyone in the world followed the WHO guidelines for fruits and vegetables, which is 400 grams per day, shown in red are countries in the past, 1990, 2015, present, and into the future in three different climate scenarios from better to worse. By 2050, we in the food supply do not have enough fruits and vegetables to meet that recommendation. Now, in the past, and into the future. So while there's great to have recommendations around fruits and vegetable intake, if the global food supply can not meet that demand, that is a problem, and we need to reorient our agriculture systems. The third strategy the Eat Lancet recommended was sustainably intensify food production and increase high quality output. And we know that in Europe, we need to increase the sustainability of food production. In Africa, they have great potential. They just don't have the technologies, the inputs to be able to meet that sustainable intensification. In places like the U.S. and Europe, we use way too much fertilizer, way too much pesticides, although that's being managed quite well now. But we need to transfer some of that redistribution and make it food production technologies and inputs much more sustainable across the world. So we need to help smallholder farmers in Africa be able to bump up their yields and for us to move much more, us being high-income countries, move much more into sustainable production practices. The fourth strategy is better governance on land, but also in oceans. We need more protection of natural ecosystems, more conservation, zero land expansion. And if we do expand into managed lands and not expand into biodiverse hotspots, think the Amazon, and restore degraded lands. We also need to really think about oceans, restoring fish stocks, thinking about sustainable aquaculture as an alternative. And the last step strategy is cutting food loss and waste in half. And we know that food loss at the farm gate or on farms is significant, particularly in low-income countries or countries that are emerging, like in sub-Saharan Africa. You see a lot of loss of food on production and during storage, whereas in high-income countries, you see most of it in the retail space and at the household space. So there's a lot more we can do to improve on food loss and waste through education campaigns, through better technologies on farm, and during distribution, storage, and processing. And this last slide is from the FAO, WHO, recommending different recommendations towards meeting sustainable and healthy diets. And I really like these recommendations, but they talk a lot about enabling environment. We need governments to step in. We need them to help farmers. We need them to help consumers. We need them to help private sector with positive incentives, the right incentives, to think about health and sustainability and not just profit. And they really call a lot for better data, better policy coherence, more capacity building, and better dietary guidelines that incorporate both health and the environment and what the food supply can bear. And we'll talk next week about social and equity issues and ethical issues, thinking about healthy diets and sustainable diets. And in the following 2 weeks, we'll get into solutions.